Okay, जी बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम. टुडे इज़ अवर लेक्चर नंबर टू विच विल कवर यूनिट नंबर टू ऑफ योर कोर्स विच इज़ इंट्रोडक्शन टू आईसीटी और बेसिक्स ऑफ आईसीटी. द कोड ऑफ योर कोर्स इज़ 5403. इन फर्स्ट यूनिट वी वेंट थ्रू द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ आईसीटी इन विच वी डिस्कस्ड ओवरऑल the definition of ICT, what is IT, how it is like useful in our society, and how it is being used in different fields and organizations. So in today's unit, we will dig down more about the computer. The title of your unit is Overview and Organization of Computer. So first, overall, we just got an overview of computer and its usage in our society. Now we will only see what is computer exactly, how it is being organized. So whatever, if you want to study anything, so the organization of that thing is very important. For example, if you want to study Pakistan, so you will see how Pakistan is being organized, what are the big like pillars of just like which are being supported by the system. Or if you want to study Islam, so you will study the what is the organization of Islam, what are the basic pillars of the Islam. So in this unit we will go through the overview of the organization of computer. So these are the contents of this unit, in which we will cover the history, how the computer has been emerged from history till to date, and few like popular names who worked like major for the computer, in which Abacus machine, Napier Bones, Blaise Pascal, and Charles Babbage. He's one of the like very popular name. He's also like referred as the father of computer. Then we will go through the generation of computers, so how it emerged like time by time, and how can we classify the computers based on sizes and based on the processing speeds and different functionalities. And then we will again see the applications of computers, which we also studied in first unit as well, and the important terminologies within the computer, how it is being managed by the buses and the other memory things. So let's go through with brief history. I will also upload my previous recorded lecture on this topic as well, and I will also record this lecture, and I will upload just like I did it for the first one. Also, you have to attempt the quiz and the discussion forum which I have posted for the lecture number one. It is very easy and short quiz, so you have to attempt that quiz. And also in the forum I have posted one question, and you have to respond it like whatever view you have. It doesn't matter like it is correct or not, it will not be judged like it is right or wrong. You just have to give your opinion on that specific topic in the forums, and also answer the quizzes. So to study anything, history is very important. We cannot isolate the history from anything. Even if you want to study like Pakistan, so you must know what is the history of Pakistan. And for anything, if you are like doing any research work, so first, in any research work, the literature review is very important. You cannot just write the research paper, or you cannot just start doing the research. What is the first step in everything? You study the history. So you link your work with the history. Just like now, if you're doing anything, so it is all like based upon your history. Like you have not just joined directly, you have not directly joined this program BS of Accounting Finance. You have a history. You did your matric, you did your schooling, you did your like intermediate. So everything is being linked up. You cannot isolate, or you cannot like separate the historical things. So in every aspect, the history has like important aspect. So same goes for the computer. We cannot just start learning the computer, the current stage of the computer. to study the current stage, we should have overview of the history as well. So the objective of this unit is to describe the history and development of computer, and to differentiate the different generations of the computer, and you must be able to classify the types of computers, and you must have knowledge about the applications and different parts of the computers. So just like in our last lecture, what we did, the computer is not doing anything new. Like how I can like explain this term, it is not, because humans, like since birth of the human, they are communicating, they are storing the information, they are traveling, they are communicating, but the ways have been like difference. So every other day, it's in the human nature that it improves its communication method, it improves its way of storing the things. So the computers are the latest techniques through which we can communicate and store our information. Like in the past, the information was being stored in like writing on the stones maybe, or writing on the leaves, writing on the skin of the animals, and later on we started writing on the papers, and now in this age, like in this era, we started writing on the computer or using the electricity technology. So the computer, if you see the history, in 14th century BC, BC means before Isa alayhi salam, before Christ, even before Christ, of the first century, there was an abacus machine, and this was a mechanical device which was performing some basic arithmetic operations like addition. So this is also called a type of computer, because if we just see the word computer, computer is a machine, any machine which can solve the problem, which is solving something. So this is an abacus machine, which is not an electronical device, this is a mechanical device, this is working on mechanics, there is no electricity or current in it, but it is being used to do the addition, and now to doing the addition is solving the problem of human beings. So this was called abacus machine, which was invented in 4th century BC. So you should know the name of that at least. Also, you have seen this one as a toy nowadays for the kids. In 1614, John Napier, he was a theologian and a mathematician. He invented this Napier bones, this machine was able to perform the multiplication and division as well. This was also a mechanical machine. It was not an electronical machine. Similarly, in 1623, Wilhelm Schickard, he also built a mechanical calculator, which was able to perform the process of multiplication, and this device supported 6-digit capacity. So if you look around, after every some time, the things are getting improved, but the objective is the same, solving the problem. Okay, so this is also called a computer. This can be called a simple, like in simple definition. And later on, Blaise Pascal, he was a very famous French mathematician. In 1642, he developed a mechanical calculator, and it was able to add and subtract two numbers directly and multiply and divide by repetition as well. So it supported 8-digit capacity. So this machine was called Blaise Pascal mechanical machine. This is the major change, which is the like basis of today's computer. That's why we call Charles Babbage the father of computers. So the Charles Babbage in 1820, he designed a machine, he called it difference engine. And in 1842, he invented another device named of analytical engine, a mechanical computer that was able to perform basic mathematical problem at an average speed of 60 additions per minute. So this was like physically very large. So this was the basic start of the computer, of today's computer, a machine like which is able to perform different like calculations. So the basic calculation is all mathematical. So here comes the generation of computers. So with the passage of time, several changes were made in computer technology to meet the challenges, and these challenges or the modifications were classified into different periods, and later on these periods were named as generation. So So if you see even in previous like pages, so every other researcher, every other mathematician or any person who is like willing to solve the problem of the society, he came up with a new idea, with more better solution of solving the problem. So the same process was like followed later as well. But what the scientists did, what researchers did, they categorized those areas, those technologies into different like years and called them generations. So in first generation, like in 1951 to 58, what was the technology? The first generation of were those computers which were using vacuum tubes. So the vacuum tubes is the keyword. You should remember this one. In first generation of computers, they were using vacuum tubes, and due to these vacuum tubes, they were large in size. Alright. So they were taking a lot of space, a lot of heat was also emerged from them. So these are the attributes of first generation computers. And they used to process the things line by line. The sequential processing called batch processing technique, where data was processed in the form of bundles of batches. Just like if you remember the cassette, radio cassette, in which previously it was used to listen the songs. So you cannot directly go to the last song. You have to follow, you have to reverse, you have to like, your reel will like pass by from one song to the till end. You have to wait, and if you want to listen to the last song. So it means the sequential processing. So the first generation computers, they relied on machine language, which consisted of binary instructions 0 and 1. By 0 and 1, 0 means there is no current, and 1 means current. So it was also, and later the assembly language was also introduced, which was using the special names instead of codes. Okay. So what were the limitations of first generations? Because of vacuum tubes, they generated heat and covered a lot of spaces. These things you have to remember, okay? And punch card technology consumed large number of cards, even for small programs. And magnetic tapes were unable to retrieve large amount of data quickly, so it being a sequential medium. During 1950-1964, we named it second generation. What was the major change? Instead of vacuum tubes, transistors were used. So instead of using vacuum tubes, because it was the problem of vacuum tube was they were large in size and they were like emitting a lot of heat. So what technologists or the engineers or the scientists, what they invented? They invented transistors. So the transistors were electronic component. So it was also solving the problem. It was like computing the problem, but they reduced the problems because they were smaller in size as compared to vacuum tubes, and some high level languages were also be able to compute using those programming languages, which is called Fortran. You have to remember these are the keywords. Fortran means formula translation, and COBOL means common business oriented language, and BASIC means, do you know what is the abbreviation of BASIC, any one of you? Can you type the abbreviation of BASIC? GW BASIC, sometimes we call it GW BASIC and BASIC as well. Areeb, Sadia, do you know the abbreviation of BASIC, BASIC programming language? Please respond me if you are like able to hear me. Are you listening to me? Okay, do you know the abbreviation of BASIC? Just like Fortran means formula translation, COBOL means common business oriented language, and BASIC means beginners. Have you ever heard about this? Yes, beginners. All purpose, yes. And what? Symbolic code, yes. Symbolic instruction code, yes. I is for instruction. Basic means beginner's all-purpose symbolic instruction code. This is a programming language. Even this language was being taught in matric level in Pakistan as well. I'm not sure today's it is being taught or not. Okay, in what were the advantages of this simulation? The transistors were very much reliable as compared to the vacuum tubes and have greater computational speed. The speed was increased and transistors required no warm-up time, so they did not like emit heat, a lot of heat, and they consumed less electricity. So in third simulation, which is during 1965 to 70, those transistors were being replaced with integrated circuits. All right, so the ICs were more smaller as compared to the transistors and they have a better performance than the transistors, and the keyboard and monitors were also being used, and Pascal was being used at high level languages in third generation. So what were the advantages of third generation? That ICs were more reliable than transistors, and definitely more reliable than vacuum tubes as well, and silicon chips were cheap because of their small size, and they also consumed less electricity. So by the time is coming more like our computing speed is increasing and our size is also decreasing. Just like when I was like studying in intermediate, we were not having laptops, we were using desktop computers, and nowadays it is very like common to have a laptop, and now everything is possible on mobile as well. And in European countries and in other developed countries, everything is possible on handheld like devices, or maybe smart watches and maybe smart glasses. So everything is possible even using glasses as well. So things are getting smaller and more faster. So the fourth generation, which is like after 1980, so it were based on two technologies, which is called, these are the keywords which I'm highlighting. You should remember these keywords from exam point of view or like from quiz point of view. So the fourth generation were using large scale integration, LSI, and very large scale integration, VLSI. So what was good about this technology, that this LSI was about 30,000, it had 30,000 electronic components were fabricated in a single chip, while in VLSI technology, about 1 million electronic components were fabricated in a single chip. So the keyboards and monitors were also being used, magnetic tapes were being used. So later on, in the fifth generation, which is late 1990s, in fifth generation, many new other technologies came in, like voice recognition, optical fiber, artificial intelligence, and still we are working on it. Like things are being, the computer is more like acting like a human being, behaving like a human being. It cannot become a human being, but humans are trying to make the computer to act like a human being, which is called artificial intelligence. That's why we call it artificial. How we can classify the computers, like how can we categorize the computer based on different things? So one classification is based on the size, like size, how big they are, physical appearance. So based on size, and we will again categorize the computer based on the purpose, its usage. If we categorize this the computer into like based on size, so there are the classifications like microcomputers. The microcomputers is derived from the word micro, means the smaller one. It is also called a PC. A PC is also called a microcomputer, which is a budget computer being used by a person for personal. The other categorization is a laptop computers. By name, it is like reflecting the things. Laptop, like a computer which is being placed on your lap. So normally laptop can, by definition, it should be placed on your lap basically. So the laptop computers are also called notebook computers. So this type of computer, they are portable because you cannot take around your PC or anywhere like in your office. And then so the laptops are handy, so you can take them to your university, office, or anywhere like during your traveling. So they are popular because they're easy to carry anywhere, for example traveling, definitely. And then comes the mini computer, usually falls between the microcomputers and the mainframe. A mini computer supports the hundreds of users simultaneously. So they are in between microcomputer and mainframe computer. this is an example of a mini computer. And what are the mainframe computers? The mainframes are like more larger in size. They were expensive and their processing speed was extremely high. Normally they are being used by different organizations, high-end organizations like defense. They are being used by many space agencies. So the main feature of the mainframe computer, it was capable of supporting thousands of users simultaneously. So just like we have in Allama Iqbal University, we have a lot of servers. So we have a lot of mainframe computers, like supercomputers, we can call it. Or the more appropriate example would be our space agencies, maybe Sparko. They are having a large supercomputers. And similarly, if you are using Facebook, so Facebook, it cannot run on a simple like personal computer. So they need to have like supercomputers, because millions or billions of users are connected to their systems and servers. So such kind of big companies, they need a mainframe like big computers, which are capable to solve many problems, or they are able to serve simultaneously. Then comes the handheld computers, and by name it is reflecting the computers which is being held on your hand. It is very much small in size, which can be easily carried out. Your mobile phones can be called like handheld, because these days your mobile phones are smart enough. They act like a computer. It is not like there's as such no big limitations if we compare your smartphone with your laptop or other computers. Then the one categorization may be called as palm top. Palm means your hand, which can be like placed on your palm. These are the computers which can be easily carried out in hands or palm, and that is why this is called palm top computers, are specifically designed for special functions like phone books, calendars. Nowadays these things are absolutely like, now they are not being used, because nowadays our phones are smart enough, and they are very powerful and very intelligent, and they are covering all the aspects of all categories maybe. Then the other category is PDA, which is called personal digital assistant, which is a type of palm top computer which contains features of computing, faxing and networking. So even these things are now like obsolete, as I told you earlier. Okay, now if we categorize the computer based on the purpose, previously we were categorizing the computer based on the size, like we have given them different name based on their physical appearance. Now we are categorizing the computers based on their purpose. So if we see based on purpose, so there are three categories. One may be called a digital computer, analog computer, and a hybrid computer. And by name it is reflecting, it is self-explanatory, that digital computer which will work on the digits, like on the current, like on the 0 and 1s. 0 means no current, 1 means current. And analog means which is not working on digital things. Just like even your clock, wall clock, maybe if it is not a digital clock, it can be called as an analog computer. And a hybrid is a computer which is using mixed approach. Okay, the digital computer is just like a computer, we have already discussed this. And analog computers is used to special purpose application, for the wheel balancing, measuring temperature, even clocks, everything which is not using the current and solving the problem, it can be called analog computer. Because computer is not only a personal computer. Normally what we when we see the word computer, we refer it to a personal computer or a desktop computer which is placed in our home. So computer by definition is a device which computes, which solves the problem. And if it is digital computer, it is using digital current. Analog computer means the device which is not using the current, it is working on analog manual thing to solve the problem. Even a calculator will come under which category? Calculator will come in which category? Is it a digital computer or analog computer? Please comment in the chat box. Welcome Numala Nasif. Numala has joined us. So my question is, a calculator. We use calculator almost for mathematical things. So calculator, can we call calculator a computer? Can we call calculator a computer? Yes, anyone can answer me. Areeb, Numala, Sadia, Kashif. Can we call calculator a computer? If yes, in which category it will fall? Is it a digital computer? Is it an analog computer or a hybrid computer? Yes, anyone else please? Can we call calculator a computer? Okay, Numala is saying yes, we can call. Why analog? Yes. Okay, first answer is okay, yes. Because calculator is also solving the problem. It is computing something. So by generic definition, we can call calculator a computer, and it is a digital one. Why it is analog? It is working on digit, it is working on current. It can be called a digital computer because it is working on circuits, it is working with cell. So cell is providing it electricity, and the screen which is visible on your calculator is a digital screen. The digits are not manual, like they cannot be touched, just like a wall clock or any other. So the calculator can be called a generic computer, or it can be categorized as a digital computer. So every terminology in our society, there are two meanings of every one. Is called the actual meaning, or maybe called literal meaning, and one is the contextual meaning. In Urdu we call it laghvi maine and istilahi maine. Have you heard about this terminology? For every word there is a literal means laghvi maine, and contextual which means istilahi maine. So computer, if we see it like with literal meaning or laghvi maine, so everything these things are covered in computer. Calculators, your wall clocks, your meters, everything, they are by definition they are computer. But the contextual meaning, or the istilahi, what you say in Urdu, the istilahi meaning of computer is normally a digital computer, is a laptop, is a personal computers. Normally it is the contextual meaning. Okay, so the hybrid computers are those which are using both digital data and analog data as well. So both the features, if any system is using both features, so it may be called as hybrid. Hybrid means using both the things. So what are the applications of computers? We have already discussed in unit number 1, but those were the applications of ICT in general. So now we will just go through what are the applications of computers. Applications means its usage in different fields. So it is being used in education, definitely, just like right now we are using computer. You are also using computer, whether it is a mobile phone or a laptop or a personal computers. So it can be used in education, whether they are like projectors. Projector is also a computer, like it is solving or helping us online slides, everything. So it is being used in education, it is being used in business, definitely. Every other business now, they are coming up with technology, they are making their website, they are having the accounting software to contact customers. So now the computer is being used in business as well. In banking, definitely, every banking now, the conventional banking has almost ended now. No bank can like compete if they don't have the digital banking, they don't have the ATM, they don't have online banking, mobile banking. So everything is being supported by the computers. It is being used in defense as well, the computer technology. Even the defense is the initial stage. The computer was like, if you have studied the history of internet, the internet was initially used for the defense purpose by the US, which was called DARPANET. Then later on the internet emerged. in defense, and even in personal use, we are using GPS. Anybody knows what is GPS? Yes, can you define what is GPS? Are you using GPS? Or what is it? As a layman, if your father asks, or a person who is not aware, who is not using any smartphone or technology things, and he or she asks you, what is GPS? What exactly it is? Location tracking, okay. More simpler definition. What is exactly GPS? Is everybody using GPS in Pakistan? Or is everybody using GPS in China? Who is controlling this GPS? And how they are how they are tracking our location? You can also speak if you want, it's up to you. But I will motivate you. It is highly encouraged. If you want to speak, you can do a voice talk as well. It will improve your confidence level. So if anyone from you, you can just convert your from listening to speaking, you can speak as well. I want you to define GPS in simple words. Yes, please, Arib, Numala, Sadia, Kashif, anybody. Feel free, don't feel confused. I will not deduct any marks. Just enjoy the class to learn. Because I think education should not be taken as a tension. Okay, you should learn, you should enjoy the things. You just, you can explain whatever you know. Yes, anyone else, please? Sadia is saying no more idea. Arib, Numala and Kashif, if you want to speak about GPS. Okay, I will tell about. So GPS is basically a global positioning system. It is a tracking. Okay, Numala. So GPS is basically controlled by USA. Yes, satellite navigation system. So I will also share one video with you according which will tell you about the GPS and other systems. So what is satellite? Basically, there are different countries which are using different navigation systems. So GPS is based. GPS is by USA. So what exactly is GPS? Is what USA did. The USA, they have sent there around 26 satellites. There are 26 satellites which are revolving or which are around our world. So they are on the satellite, and in our phones, in our mobile phones, we have a GPS chip which is connected with those satellites. So whenever we put on our GPS chip or device, it gets the signal from at least three satellites. When it is connected with three different GPS based satellites, so based on the mathematical formula of, or the based on the formula of triangulation, it estimates. I will repeat again. So the GPS is based in USA. The USA has they have sent 26 satellites. There are 26 satellites which are being sent by the USA, which are revolving around the Earth. And your mobile phones, which your smartphones, not all the phones, the phones which have the GPS technology, which have the GPS chip. So whenever you put on your GPS option, so your mobile phone gets connected with at least three satellites. So whenever your GPS on the mobile phone, it is connected with minimum three satellites. So based on the triangulation formula, it estimates your location on the Earth. your x and y value, which we call latitude and longitude. So that latitude and longitude is used in many applications like Google Maps, by defense systems and many other mapping technologies. So this is not all alone. This is only US based. In China, they have their own. Alright, can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Is my voice, is it okay now? Can you hear my voice? Arif, Numala, Sadia and Kashif, are you able to hear me? Can you hear it now? Hello. Hello, can you hear me now? Okay, good. So we were talking about GPS. So GPS is a global positioning system which is based on 26 satellites which revolves around the earth, and your phone has the GPS chip which connects with those satellites to estimate your location. So this is not the only location system or navigation system which is being used worldwide. This is only US based system. In China, they are not using GPS. They have their own location system, which is called Beidou. Similarly, the Russia, they have their own system, maybe called GLONASS, or I'm not sure, but they have their own system. And similarly, the European Union, they have their own system, which is maybe called Galileo. So there are multiple, there are maybe more, but in Pakistan, we are used to with GPS. So the GPS is a positioning system, which is being managed by USA. It has 26 satellites around the world which gets connected with our mobile phone to estimate our location in X and Y. X means latitude and longitude, so they can pinpoint where we are on the earth. So this location is being used by many applications, just like Google Maps, like Kareem, like Uber, or many other applications which uses your X and Y location to see you, to locate you where you are right now. Did you get my point? Hello. Are you able to hear me? Okay, did you understand what is GPS, or do you want me to explain again? Okay, moving forward, definitely there are multiple usage of the computer in internet entertainment as well. This is which you already know a lot about, like watching movies, songs and many other like technology things. Everything is being, and in sports as well, definitely in sports computers are being used now. And you, if you even see the cricket, how it is being like analyzed using, whether it is a ball speed of the ball, whether it is to identify whether it is out or not. So everything is being even calculated and even predicted using the computer as well. So what are the important other terminologies within the physical computer? So the one of the important terminology is bus. So what is the purpose of bus in, so again, what is the purpose of bus in regular sense? The purpose of bus is to take different passengers from one location to other location, to take information from one location to other location. Similarly, the computer has buses to take different information or take different things. So every bus has a capacity, just like in real scenario, there could be a bus which can take 100 passengers. There could be a bus which can take like accommodate 20 passengers. There are different categories. There can be a different categories of buses, which can be like, there are employee buses, there are student buses. There can be a bus which is only able to take the luggage only, or the buses which will only take only maybe passengers. So the similarly in computers as well, there are different buses which are called control buses, which takes the controls signals. And the address buses are just like the luggage buses. They just take the luggage in them, and the data buses takes the data in them. Similarly, there are different terminologies like data bus. The data bus, by name it is clear, the bus which takes the data, transfer the data. Address bus which takes the addresses. Control bus which controls and commands. And there is the width of the bus, and width means how much data can be transferred. Just like I told you earlier, there can be a bus, and there can be a speed as well. How, at what rate the data of speed data will be traveled or transferred. Computer ports means the linkages. Just like in real scenario, we have airports, we have ship ports. What are the ports basically? Ports are the connecting things. If you want to go to Dubai, UAE, you are going by air, so you will directly go to the airport. You cannot land anywhere else. So if you are going by ship, you will go to the ship port. Similarly, the data cannot be traveled like freely. It always travels through the ports, the links. Just like if you want to transfer your data using a USB flash drive or maybe any other hard drive. So in ports, just like I told you, in real scenarios there are different kinds of ports. Just like for aeroplanes there are airports, for ships there are ship ports and seaports, which we call, and similarly for the buses there could be bus ports. In computers as well, there are different categories of the ports. So one is called serial ports, which have like serial, takes the data in serial. One are the parallel ports, which are normally used for the printers, and these are normally not being used right now. Now we are using more USB port for everything. So these were being used for mouse and keyboards, and this one is called used for the joysticks and game ports. So the basic difference is between the number of pins and the data transfer rate. Now the USB is more faster, that's why things are being moved towards USB. So what is the microprocessor? It is the brain of the computer. Just like in a human being, every decision is being made by our brain. So in computers, there is the microprocessor chip which makes all the decision, which is called CPU as well. So CPU is not a box. Normally in personal computers, normally we refer this CPU to a box, which is the actual name of the box is casing. The CPU is only a small chip which is on the motherboard of the computer, which is the brain of the computers, which is responsible to take the decisions. And what kind of decisions? There are two parts of CPU. One is ALU, which is responsible for arithmetic, means mathematical multiplication, and logical means less than and greater than problems. It decides. Okay, so within CPU there is an ALU and there is a CU. So CU control unit is connected with input and output devices like your keyboard, mouse, printers, and supported by the storage, which is like hard drive and other storage devices. And this part of CPU is an ALU, which is responsible for doing the calculation, arithmetic calculation or a logical calculation. So these are the example of arithmetic calculations, and if A is greater than B, this is the example of a logical problem. So what is the control unit? It is the overall controlling supervisor, which is controlling, which is getting the data from input devices and getting it solved by the processor. So the memory is a place where data is being saved temporarily. So memory is further divided into two, like primary memory and secondary memory. Just like in human being, we have one primary memory. Just like when we are traveling, or even right now, we are looking at the screen and everything is being, we can read it. So everything is being stored in our temporary memory. We are not remembering it. Once we like look at it or read it again and again, and we try to store that information in our secondary storage to make it permanent so that we may remember it always. And sometimes we note it down in our diaries. Our diaries are maybe also called secondary devices, just like in computers. So the primary memory is basically a RAM, which is a temporary memory. So within the RAM, there can be a multiple like categories, which is called dynamic RAM or SRAM, which is static RAM. So dynamic RAM, which is a RAM which refreshes itself again and again, it is dynamic, and static RAM is which do not refresh it again and again. You can further read about these. There are different types of the DRAM and the SRAM. Okay, it does not need refreshing and it refresh itself again and again. So which is cost. Secondary memory is a secondary storage. They are permanent. There can be many, like hard disk, CDs, optical drives, magnetic tapes, your flash drive, your USB flash drives. Okay. Nowadays we are talking, they are terabytes. There are multiple, in optical there are multiple flavors like CDs, DVDs, Blu-rays. I think you know better about these. DVD has more capacity. R means recordable, you can record it and rewrite it in RW. And this is the motherboard of the computer system. Motherboard is the skeleton. Just like in a human being, we have a skeleton and everything is fitted, everything is like adjusted within our skeleton. So the motherboard is the main skeleton in which all the things are being connected. Your processor, your hard drive, your slots, your USBs. So it is the main, that's why it is called motherboard. So this was our today's lecture, in which we covered the organization of the computers. We studied within how the computer is working. We studied what the brief history of the computers, how the ports play important role, and what are the uses of computers in our like daily applications. We classified the computers different from different aspects. So this was today's lecture. I hope you have learned something. So in next lecture we will continue with our unit number 3.